Thank you, Dr. Chundrima, for inviting me. And believe me, it's been a huge learning experience. And I have to thank Dr. Harsha Rao, who's not here, but who's helped me immensely in understanding and also in interpreting various images in OCTA. So the question is, how close are we to prime time? And we all know that optical coherence tomography is a wonderful tool. We all have used it in various machines. It's a non-invasive, non-contact imaging modality, providing you high-resolution cross-sectional images of various tissues. Drawbacks, of course, interpatient invariability in optic nerve head morphology, which is extremely important for us. And we have also the macular thickness for glaucoma detection, and we all know why. And if you look at this simple printout of an OCT by the RTVU, and you find that it gives you immense amount of information, beginning from the GCC. This is the GCC over here, and the optic nerve head. And we love to see whether there are corresponding features or not. But we also know that, you know, when we are doing an OCT, that there are certain areas which need to be, we need to look at, for example, this area. And look at the left eye, and we find the left eye is practically normal. And of course, we look at the inter-eye asymmetry and see whether which one is more defective or not. And what is very interesting is that it is not dependent upon the patient's response. So those people who are not able to do, let's say, a perimetry, for us at least it becomes one tool by which we are able to follow up a patient. It provides highly objective information on the retinal layer's thicknesses, and it is repeatable and reproducible also. So why do we have to search for a new tool? But problem is that OCT is not the best method to detect changes where you have advanced glaucoma. And we all know that because of the floor effect in advanced glaucoma, you just have some neural elements lying over there, but we actually do not have the retinal nerve fiber layer. In some machines, it's between 50, let's say 50 to 70%. We find that after that, you can't make out whether actually you have retinal nerve fiber layers present. Then why don't we do the visual fields in these cases? Because this is definitely more clinically relevant to us, especially in advanced glaucomas, because it's measuring a visual function. But we all know that visual fields require immense amount of concentration on the patient's behalf, cooperation by the patient. It definitely has lower repeatability and reproducibility, especially in those people who have advanced glaucomas. And there's a huge amount of fluctuations in perimetric results, therefore slightly difficult to define actual glaucomatous progression. And what is very, very well known to all of us is that visual fields can detect damage after it is already recognizable in the structural exams. That means 25 to 30% of retinal ganglion cells have been lost before abnormalities come in the visual fields. So why OCTA? Because we know that there are two theories about glaucoma. The first theory is the mechanical theory. This unfortunately cannot explain progressive disease, especially when those people who have low IOPs. Then comes the vascular theory. This is what it's impaired regulation of ocular blood flow, results in periods of relative ischemia that damages the optic nerve. So what about this vascular theory? Can we detect these blood vessels? Can we know whether the vessel density has actually reduced or not? Therefore, the search and hunt has always been on for a simple and non-invasive but reproducible method for evaluating the blood flow. We all know that there are many methods have been obtained for determining blood flow, but all of us know that they are not reproducible and we get varied readings at varying times of the day. This particular modality has been approved by FDA in the late 2016. It is a non-invasive procedure, and by this method we are measuring the vessel density with higher repeatability and also reproducibility. So what is OCTA actually? It is a method of non-invasive imaging of the blood vessels in the optic nerve head and in the retina in vivo. It potentiates our understanding of the role of ocular blood flow and also retinal microvasculature in glaucoma. It provides a quantitative assessment of vessel density, which is something that we would love to know. It also allows us a three-dimensional imaging, and we don't have to put in a dye, which is an invasive procedure, especially in FA, which is FFA. So why not other procedures? Because it does not allow a direct observation of the microvasculature within the discrete layers of the retina and optic nerve head. And it is not possible to obtain accurate, reproducible, quantitative measures by of the retinal vasculature by these other technologies like speckle flow, splography, etc. This is just to show us and make us revise as to what is the retinal vasculature like. So OCT images large vessels and microvasculature of the retina and OHA by just performing multiple OCT scans of the same region. Now you have a machine which has the OCT, which you are very familiar with, and what has been included in is the OCTA. So one machine which is giving us two bits of information, excepting for the additional software which is helping us to analyze where the vessel or what the vessel density is. So what we are measuring is what is the variation in the OCT signal at each location. Now these are the moving particles, let's say the RBCs in the blood vessels. This results in high variance in the OCT signal between the scans, and this is the one that is used to identify the blood vessels. Mind you, this is a surrogate one. We are not actually being able to see the blood vessels. What we are actually doing is that, okay, if the signal, the backscattering of the signal is coming in a varied form, we are presuming that this backscattering is coming from the RBCs. So various algorithms have been detected, one of which, the commonest of which, is the SSDA, or the split spectrum decorrelation angiography by GIA, and OMAG I'm specially mentioning because it has also been taken up by the CIRIS and the others also, of course, there. By the split spectrum, which is the most established approach, it uses a variation in the intensity of the OCT signal to identify blood vessels. Whatever is the fluctuating value of OCT intensities, that is considered to be decorrelation, and that is what we are taking as to be the blood vessels. So this is just an OCT scan of the optic disc, where you are taking a 4.5 millimeter, and the software automatically fits an ellipse in the optic margin, and this is the peripapillary region, which is a 0.75 wide elliptical annulus extending from the optic disc boundary and divided into six sectors. And this is, of course, the superficial macular density, which is again calculated over 1.5 millimeter circular annulus centered on the macula. And this is a peripapillary OCT of a normal individual. If we look at this, we find that a person has a normal optic disc, normal field. And if you look at the this image that is, I'm sorry, there is nothing by which I can point out, but dense peripapillary capillaries are present in the angiography image. You just go to the heat map, where I have written this heat map, you find that the blood vessels are absolutely normal, and the vessel densities are given in various, in different sectors in the absolute right-hand side. And this is of the OCTA, macular OCTA, which is showing us the superficial blood vessels. And this is of a person who has mild glaucoma. Obviously, again, if you just look at the heat map and you find that there is a sector which shows us a lot of blue. That blue is telling us that the blood vessels have decreased. And the vessel density in that area also showing that it is decreased. And OCT in the macula in this area, again, that same thing shows us, the heat map tells us. Now, I'm sorry, I've not even gone into the... So advantages are basically that it is repeatable in healthy and glaucomatous eyes, and the discriminative powers are definitely better. But before I conclude, I must tell you that these multiple studies which have been done on the OCTA, it tells us about a stronger vascular function association compared to a stronger thickness function association by this means. And vascular flow may reduce in eyes with sick or damaged ganglion cells even before there is obvious reduction in RNFL, which is of two advantage. And we have to understand that there are lots of controversies in this. Majority of studies that assess OCTA measurements in POAG normal eyes have shown that older age to be associated with lower macular and peripapillary vessel densities. So we have to have a huge normative database, which I don't think is available. And exercise, systemic diseases also affect OCTA measurements. Therefore, these are going to affect our results. Will myopia, people with myopia, will OCTA help? No, unfortunately, this is the answer. So again, the dilemma that arises in glaucoma, in myopic glaucoma patients still remains. Other factors are definitely image artifacts affect. Peripapillary OCTA alterations are not disease specific. That means we can't say that this vessel density decreases in this manner, except only in glaucoma. In various diseases, it may be just about the same thing. And IOP lowering has only been found in one study by Hollow, where a small number of patients who were treated with antihypertensives, glaucoma drugs, there we find that the vessel density definitely increased. So Is OCT helpful in detecting early glaucoma? Some eyes, I again say in red, I've marked it, some eyes with microvascular attenuation occurs before changes in RNFL. So OCTA can possibly help in these. Which are those eyes? We don't know. In advanced glaucoma, yes, probably. This definitely may be able to help us. Finally, there is currently no final decision can be made on various OCT parameters, usefulness for measurement of glaucomatous progression or conversion of ocular hypertension to glaucoma, the diagnostic value in perimetric glaucoma or their utility as indicators of visual field preservation after intraocular pressure lowering interventions as by G. Hollow. But I still would say that OCTA has promise for improving early diagnosis, detection of progression, risk assessment, and possibly detecting dysfunctional RGCs for future neuroprotective therapies. Thank you for a patient listening.